The Technological African Dream, Mark Miller. Copyright 2021, Mark Miller, the Micronet Media Services. Contents. 1. Descendant. 2. Nutrition. 3. Beauty. 4. Warlord. 5. Legend. 6. Diaspora. 7. Leadership. 8. Machiavelliana. 9. Ambassador. 10. Love. 11. Sweet. 12. Treason. 13. Aggression. 14. Mockery. 15. Pride. 16. Revelation. 17. Science. 18. Differentiation. And 19, fall. New York University, in the class of 2119. A student has a question. Professor, what was segregation? The professor responds, good question. The short answer is intellectual fratricide. Log back in after class if you need to know more. Descendant. Shardhu Shejola is tall, taller than any Amazon queen of antiquity. Her skin is as dark as the finest mahogany, her head shaped like that of an elegant, dark velvet puma, resting upon a tall, sophisticated neck. Her eyes blaze like the description given by astrophysicists of the supernova stars at the birth of the universe. Shardhu Shejola is a Nigerian dignitary, an African stateswoman in her early 30s, descended from the Nigerian ethnic group of Ashantiwawa, a proud people that had slipped into anonymity, as African folklore has it, during the onset of the colonial dissemination of African pride, their people and culture. The Ashantiwawa avoided non-African culture, learning only the deepest mysteries of their own, like the prophecies and wisdom of their cultural history that was passed down through song, dance, and storytelling. Not written word, instead, a griot oratory tradition. And so, it could not be found in any foreign archive of law. Shardhu Shejola was undoubtedly an African woman, a perfect exponent of the race of Nigeria. There was no trace of Europe, Asia, Antipodes, or India in her deoxyribonucleic acid. She had listened intently to her kin during her formative years, absorbing knowledge, diligently creating for herself a purposeful existence. She was born in 2009 in Bawaja, a township set apart and undocumented in Western annals because its name was hidden from non-African tongues to protect its purpose. Bawaja was home to the heirs of the old line of the African royal tribes. There were two of these communities, considered safe havens in every distinct territory on the African continent. The bloodline of the royal families was revered, protected, and maintained. The inhabitants, and more specifically, the chieftains of these communities, the Obeijas, had sworn down through the ages to protect the bloodline of the royal houses of Africa. This they had done by ignoring the complex ensnarement of the wider community in their dealings with non-Africans. The Obeijas observed as great African kingdoms, leveraged with foreign wealth and non-African intellect, rose and fell, taking the pride and courage of their empires down in amongst the retinue of their ruin. The Obeijas wept, but did nothing as theirs was to observe, and based upon the conclusion of their observation, keenly seek more so to protect the royal bloodline of Africa. The Obeijas would hold periodic council together to decide whether to convey knowledge and their thoughts upon what they had observed to the Lekgalejas, the knowledge class of wisdom and understanding. To do this was a most solemn event. The Lekgalejas were not to be bothered with trifles because of the intensity of their intellect, which spanned 9.5 millennia BCE. Concerning the human history of all races defining civilization, 100 years was a small period to the Lekgalejas. Through direct neuronal genetic inheritance, they had passed knowledge, wisdom, and understanding down through their generations. Non-Africans were oblivious to their existence. The Lekgalejas walked as everyday figures, assuming a dual personality, on the one hand often depicted as the African incompetent by non-African commentators, as their periodic babbling was considered incoherent babble by non-Africans. On the other hand, they were revered as the enthusiasts of knowledge, wisdom, and understanding to those they considered to be pure exponents of their race. In 2021, following the destruction of the Triple Towers in the United States of America, the Obeyjahs convened a meeting in Sierra Leone, where it was decided that this event overmost marked an important departure in the accepted evolution of humankind. Many in that meeting disagreed and cautioned against reading too deeply into the event, but a majority eventually agreed that this event and their thoughts should be conveyed to the Leth Kalajas. A meeting was held in February 2026 in Bawaja, a place renowned for being the ancient seat of the highest chieftains of the Ashanti Wawa. Of that meeting, little can be said here, but that the Leth Kalajas, who were also not oblivious to the events of 2021 and the ensuing fundamentalist wars, received the thoughts of the Obeyjahs with profundity, issuing in lieu of those thoughts and spiritual edict that all the royal children of the Banta-mina, the kings and queens of ancient Afrique, should be delivered to their local Leth Kalajas for tutoring and formal instruction in the proactive use of knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. It is recounted that the parents of the royal offspring fell upon their knees and shed innumerable tears of joy at this monumental proclamation. It had been 600 years since the Leth Kalajas had granted impartation of this kind of power to those of the royal bloodline of Africa. The various children of the Banta-mina, without delay, were delivered to the local Leth Kalajas for tutoring, a 20-year course of mentorship, trial, and study. Shardhu Shejola was one of those children from the Bawaja Ashanti Wawa in Nigeria. Her Leth Kalaja Mimajo Binkuwa later remarked that she was extremely impressed with the aptitude of the young Shardhu. Again, it should be restated, as it is important, that Shardhu Shejola was exceedingly beautiful. Her physical appearance, disposition, and momentum was finer by far than any artifact or genetically engineered thing ever created or conceived of by the hand or mind of any genius on our planet. Her received instruction, though fast-tracked, was thorough, spanning all disciplines across human existence, concerning all five continents of planet Earth. Nutrition. Ambassador Zhu Xiangmei sat in Jadua, an exclusive restaurant in an affluent section of Lagos, Nigeria. Untouched by the rebel supporters now marauding through the commercial and residential streets of most of Nigeria's major cities and communities, now embarrassingly stripped of security or emergency services. The ambassador summoned the waiter. From the menu, he ordered raw tuna steaks, couscous with grated lemon, orange, and grapefruit rind, fresh coriander, and African wild rice. He supped on his cup filled with green tea and fresh Nigerian chew, bee honey. Fresh atmospheric garden music played in the background. Wooden flutes blended with a slow, mid-paced bongo drum beat, peppered with the sound of wild waterfalls, melded together to create a sense of jungle enchantment, surrounded by the misty aroma of posh spice and distinctive 21st century Nigerian fine wine. Ambassador Zhu Xiangmei leaned forward to read the page now appearing on the display screen of his CCC, resting on the white tablecloth. A breaking news alert from the Chinese embassy, a communique that had been relayed from Beijing announcing in Mandarin the overthrow of the Nigerian government of President Inchok Hukwe, as reported by the Western media agencies. Reflexively, he sighed. "This is simply not true," he told himself. The waiter returned with Ambassador Xu Xiangmei's lunch, placing it on a plate mat before him. The ambassador began eating, lifting his fork with a sliver of raw white tuna garnished with coriander. He motioned about to eat, but his eyes caught sight of a pair of chocolate-hued knees heading in his direction. With masculine distinctiveness, his eyes followed the pair of chocolate knees furtively upward in order to discover their owner's identity. Immediately, he recognized the knee's beautiful owner. This Nigerian dignitary was well known in diplomatic circles. The ambassador set down his knife and fork. He placed his napkin on the right side of his table as he arose and bowed his head to greet this beautiful woman in simplified Mandarin, because all knew that this personage was versed well in all business tongues. "Minister Shardhu Shejola, welcome. If I knew you would be here, I would have waited before ordering lunch. Please, let me call the waiter. Join me. Be my guest at lunch. I must insist." Minister Shejola bowed her head lower than Ambassador Zhu Xiangmei's head in deference to his rank, then smoothly replied in her velvet Kakoa Nigerian accent, "Ambassador Zhu Xiangmei, this is most kind of you. I am honored to be your guest at lunch." She sat, her cream two-piece suit shimmered intermittently, a contrast against the chocolate hue of her delicately dark skin. Her eyes appeared large and soft, her lashes gently flickered up and down in response to the occasional glance from the ambassador as he intermittently studied her face between lunching. Carefully, the ambassador sliced his raw white tuna steak, watching as Minister Shejola took the menu from the outstretched arm of the waiter. The minister used a moment to peruse the menu before ordering Chimera sherry salad with syrup, glazed whole pecan, complemented with a glass of exceptionally light South African Chateau Vin Blanc. The waiter returned within a reasonable time with the minister's selection. Shardhu began to eat, then spontaneously raised her glass of wine aloft in the direction of Ambassador Xu Zhangmei. "To the industry of Micronet technology," she toasted. "Yes, indeed, Minister. But let us not forget the People's Republic of China and the Constitutional Republic of Nigeria," added the ambassador, as the golden-rimmed, fine crystal-lead wine glasses were brought together to a soft clink-chink before them as each drank. "Minister, I did not expect to see you so soon. The Western press has just announced the fall of your president's government, but I have heard nothing of this in the Lagos press." "I am en route to Abuja," she replied, without the slightest inflection in her voice or vacillation of facial expression. "Ambassador, I can assure you that His Excellency's government remains intact." The ambassador probed further. "Aha, I see. We do not consider the Western media to be furnished of an equitable quantity of integrity. That being so, may I inquire as to your opinion of the purpose of such an assertion?" "Who can discern the purpose of the Western alliance? We, the Nigerian, or even the African? No, Ambassador. As of now and before this moment, we are but a client nation of the British, and by extension the leaders of the Western Alliance. Upon their whim leans our every need, and now it seems our protection. Yes, even in this we now seek the rapacious indulgence of the British." "Quite so, Minister. Please, let us be less formal here at least. Please call me Zhu. So why have you sought a business or a private audience with me when your loyalties lie so certainly entwined with the fortunes of the British and vicariously through them to the Western Alliance?" "Dear Ambassador, familiarity could breed contempt. Let us compromise regarding formalities. I will permit you to call me Minister Shejola, and I will call you Ambassador May. How does that sound?" The ambassador smiled. "A compromise it is then, Minister Shejola." "Thank you. Ambassador May, in answer to your question, are all Nigerians suddenly, without explanation, void of commercial acumen, or even a lack of discretion, preferring commonplace assurances of an equitable distribution involving this new trade, Micronet technology, that seemingly has several vendors, or, as we believe, just one? Mr. Minister Shejola, you, to me, it appears, possess the deepest understanding and knowledge of any other dignitary I have been acquainted with in Nigeria, if not on this remarkable continent, during my tenure at the Chinese embassy. I reject the apparent appearance of juvenile politics in these jungles as it has been so often labelled abroad, because, in your eyes, I see an indescribable desire of a form I have in my many years never known. State your purpose, Minister Shejola, because you would not disturb me here at lunch if your need was not pressing." Ambassador May hailed the waiter with his eyes, whilst pointing to his teacup with his right hand, a soft, upturned, open palm gesture. The waiter headed off to the kitchen, quickly returning with a white china teapot. He placed it on the right side of the ambassador, gestured to lift and pour, but stopped as the ambassador gently waved his right hand. The waiter returned to the serving pit at the front of the dining hall, then went to serve another dining guest. Ambassador May sliced a thin sliver of raw white tuna steak from along the side of the single strip remaining on his plate. He gathered some wild rice upon and along the top side of the sliver of white tuna steak, using his knife and fork to delicately roll the sliver up until it became a small Swiss roll of white tuna steak and wild rice. The ambassador pierced the upturned roll with his fork, pressing the fork through the top of the roll, right through to its base. Then he lifted his fork with the impaled roll of white tuna steak and wild rice, dipping it into the shredded fresh coriander on his plate, until one side of the roll was thickly bespeckled green with coriander. He lifted his fork, momentarily admiring it, twisting his fork before his eyes, then in one motion, placing it whole into his mouth, moving it around with his tongue onto his molars, then began chewing, allowing the fishy juice of the white tuna steak, the soft textured wild rice, and effervescent herbal essence of the coriander to meld in his mouth. Savoring each moment of the experience, he looked up at Shardhu. She sat watching him, the way he carefully prepared what was to be devoured, how he studied it before eating, and how he chewed all the while, his face a picture of satisfaction. Beauty. Ambassador May, let us consider the abstract. Inasmuch as Micronet technology becoming an industry of sizable production throughout Nigeria, we have the capacity to facilitate its growth. This cannot be disputed. A concern that such an abstraction would not be welcomed by the Western Alliance, historically, is well founded. But what is humanity if not in part to consider an untenable future, if not for its beauty or its uneven alignments to the present, but the beauty of its potential through human conception? Ambassador May, isn't beauty hidden in all things upon closer observation? Explain how beautiful the single motion of an intentional act, clear, concise, uninhibited, deliberate, faultless, just like enjoyment of your lunch. Yes, Ambassador May. Beauty personified merely in the coordinated control of a knife, a fork, the abstract of my conception of you. My abstract idea is a visual depiction of Micronet technology, raising the living standards of my people around me, that they may sit in a restaurant like this, with a simple aptitude, innocent, individual, performing insignificant displays of beauty like those you are blessed to possess to be able to indulge. What do you mean? And what do you want, Minister Shejola? We cannot act as a wedge. Maybe we can act as a wedge between the British and your government, but your president has refused Micronet technology. Yet you sound sold on its uses. How interesting. Even so, we cannot deal with a mere dignitary, albeit a remarkably beautiful one. We can only deal with President Inchokhukwe himself, but if he does not embrace Micronet technology, then there is nothing the Chairman of the People's Republic of China can do for you, or those you come here on behalf of, Minister Shejola. Apparently so, it seems, Ambassador Chu Zhang Mei quipped, Minister Shejola, as her fork pinned a piece of chimera cherry to the plate whilst her knife clinically dissected it into four distinct pieces, the fourth piece being the largest, a crispy, scrumptious piece by far. The remaining three pieces were scant, salty skin, which the minister positioned to the side of her plate. In one graceful movement, she used her fork and knife to lift the fourth piece into her mouth, making a sensuous display of pleasure with the piece of chimera sherry. For a while, as she chewed, letting it slip down her throat, the ambassador's eyes enlarged, then narrowed as he watched Minister Shejola's gorgeous throat swallowing the chimera sherry. Chimera sherry, Ambassador May, only found in the kitchens of Lagos. To me, it represents beauty, an art form unrevealed outside of my country, my home. And so I eat it with pride, like a dutiful wife, proud and versed well in the arts of pleasure. Do you suppose that one ignorant of Chimera Sherry's origins could perform this simple display of pleasure you witnessed from me? I know they cannot, Ambassador. My duty is to my president, whose duty is to Nigeria, to serve the one who serves my beloved country is an unobjectionable opportunity for me to give pleasure. Ended the minister, as she looked into the Chinese ambassador's eyes. Her eyes widened, yet the ambassador read nothing therein but for devotion, love, and beauty. She arose. The ambassador stood in compliment. She extended her hand, he took it, placed a kiss upon it, bowed. This time, Minister Shejola remained erect as Ambassador May's lips touched the pink diamond ring of her middle finger. Minister Shejola turned and departed from the restaurant as the ambassador seated himself before pouring another cup of green tea. For a moment, Ambassador May reflected upon their conversation, revolving the words of the minister around the biological machinery of his mind. Ah, Shardhu Shejola, he thought. Micronet technology will be produced and distributed in Nigeria. Regardless, if you cannot convince President Inchokukwe, then we will support whoever rules this place. The entire intelligence community outside of Africa knows that even now, in his disgrace, the rebel general Solija secretly warms your virtuous pouch. What game are you playing? Your lover must have told you that we support his rebel cause. Ambassador Mace sends a text from his CCC, an instant reply. Wait! Russia and the Western Alliance have reached an agreement. Do not offer the General Solija support. Warlord. On the evening of the very same day that the minister and the Chinese ambassador met in Lagos, after the minister's arrival in Abuja, General Salija, son of a king, Lul Raz Chintwe Mengwitsu of the imperial dynasty of Ethiopia, encamped his forces around the hilltops of Tajitola, a fragile Nigerian outpost within visible distance of the Nigerian capital, a disparate place that the rebels laid and had secured with much slaughter in the past 2 days. The rebel forces entrenched themselves at feckless Tajitola, with the Nigerian capital city of Abuja now in their sights. 10,000 merciless warrior soldiers steadily lining up in attack formations, awaiting the order to commence the assault upon Abuja. Their bedeviled sights were set upon the palatial palace of General Salija, he who purposely ordered his troops not to destroy the three garrisons in Lagos that were loyal to President Inchokhukwe. This occurred 5 days ago. General Salija knew that the three garrisons would be marching at speed now toward the rebel position to catch them, overtake them, crush them before they attacked Abuja. The three Lagos garrisons and the three garrisons of Abuja would be sufficient to crush the rebel assault. General Salija knew this. They had 3 days to overthrow Abuja. Each day he reminded his troops that their descent upon and work in Abuja had to be brutal and quick to prevent the joining of the Lagos and Abujan presidential forces, which would equal without a doubt their irreconcilable deaths. The faces of his rebel troops looked grim, dark, redoubtably resolute, with a keen glint in each of their eyes, now hypnotically fixed upon Abuja, a gaze not of hate, just indifference, an idle disregard for the system that had both nurtured and spawned them. Their splendid uniforms, mindsets, and ferocious 21st century weapons of war, courtesy of a recent shipment from Russian President Slubotchnikov. Soon, with eagerness, they would prance upon their compatriots, be they civilian or soldier, like disloyal lions with bitterly sharp jaws of retribution and mottled claws boasting stale blood that would be mixed to dissolution with the fresh blood that they intended to gorge upon at the coming of dusk in the early morrow. General Salija directly addressed 10 cohorts of his finest warrior soldiers, a small number of those before the general had followed him from his youthful days in Ethiopia to this very hilltop. "This land you see below you, my fellow soldiers, is a harsh land. With a harsh heart that grief and guilt find fine shelter in. You, my closest brothers, are my cherished warriors. My heart has brought me here from royal Ethiopia, away from the bosom of my mother and the strong arm of my father, a king. A few of you standing before me now made that very same journey. But most of you here are children of the very soil of Nigeria, which has adopted me and my love for it. Vividly, I still recall the soil of my childhood home because I carry the smell of it in my mind. Every morning I arise, no matter how far I journey, I can smell it. Standing upon this harsh land, looking down upon Abuja, the sun going down behind me. I am fully aware of how far we have travelled to stand upon this very spot. You all should be proud of yourselves, as I am proud of you, because as time passes, I have been joined upon my journey by you, you and you. He pointed randomly at warriors. By all 10,000 of you, my beloved comrades, my brothers in arms. General, General Salija, my kin. Yes, we have travelled with you in spirit all the way, and in blood a part of the way. General, even if it was not our destiny to be with you at the eve of your journey, even that day would still remain a glorious day in our hearts, because, General, rest assured, we will follow you to your destiny's end. There is not a soldier amongst us tired in his loyalty to your bold cause. Ah, Captain Denitsu, of the loyal house of Oromia, my beloved cousin, thank you. Hear me now, my warrior soldiers. I picture only a victory in the steel pits of my mind, both in battle and in love. The warrior soldiers went silent, began to murmur in discontentment amongst one another. Upon hearing his final words, it was not good to talk of love on the eve of a major battle, especially coming from out of the very mouth of their general. Captain Denitsu stepped forward to quell the murmuring amongst the ranks. General Salija, relative, if you speak of the Imperial Minister Shardhu Shejola, although it is not our place to offer advice to the heart, we are but warriors. Still, our loyalty to you causes our tongues to spill advice upon your heart. Wait, Captain. I cannot bend even if all your words were presented in gold. Even as rebels with a cause, my heart betrays my every thought and action. I can no longer remain silent. I wait, relative. Let me tell the warriors that the power you keep in your heart can be shared amongst 10,000 hearts. I promise you, cousin, we will all benefit in victory. I know your story. Remember, I was with you that day. I am ever proud that we share blood, Captain Denitsu. Legend. Captain Denitsu stood up high upon the hilltop of Fekla's Tajitola. Using a loud voice, calling all to attention, he began talking in a forceful voice. Listen, bring food and wine for the warriors whilst I speak. I have something to tell you all. I recall to my mind how the young General Salija, a virile, able young prince, wrestled a young lion upon the rugged green plains surrounding Addis Ababa. The hot sun bore down upon his back, beating against him as he ducked, feigned, and avoided on that fateful day the ferocious claws of his mighty opponent. An opponent, I tell you, whose eyes flared with a definitive sign of death to its prey. That day its jaws dripped with saliva for the desire of dark, dulcet flesh. I remember how the young lion succumbed to the knowledge, majestic agility, single determined purpose of our general, whose biceps, like the cogwheels of modern machinery, responded without fault to his every thought and focused intention. Frustrating an opponent whose golden mane streamed like the flag of an empire as it rises to meet the zenith of its greatness, lashing out with both claws anchored by the strength of its hind legs. Thoroughly supplanted deep within the foundations of the soil of its ancestors. Like so did our mighty General Seleja thwart the flesh and bloodlust advance of a young lion, whose legendary prowess and insatiable hunger befitted it not as the mighty Seleja's powerful thighs launched him up upon the scurrilously savage muscular neck of the viscerally vicious beast. Aiming three blows in quick succession, one into the windpipe of the beast, the second to the temple, and the third and final deep between the ribcage of the twisting animal where its heart beat its final note. It was on that day, 15 years ago, that General Seleja, beloved Imperial Prince of Ethiopia, laid eyes upon a young visiting Banta-minian princess, Shardhu Shejola, as she was introduced by her Leth Kaleja Mimajo Binkuwa to the royal court at Addis Ababa. I remember the mid-evening glow of an early spring night sky reflected as a shade of blood red upon the glistening black muscular body of General Seleja as he stood panting, his mighty chest rising up and down as he quickly swallowed the air around him, inhaling profoundly. There, like a tall stoic sentinel, stood General Seleja over the body of his slain opponent, the young lion. The lion's face calm now, appearing unconcerned with the world of the living. The young general, tall, straight and black skinned, was naked but for an iridium codpiece protecting his genitalia. To all in attendance, he appeared like a bold, brave black warrior from the ancient days of the most powerful Bar Negus's dynasty of Ethiopian antiquity. With arms akimbo, legs astride, and neck held high as his powerful dreadlocked head streamed and sweated oil profusely about his shoulders. The young general's eyes were not as the eyes of contemporary young men whose eyes change as they grow to learn the harsh ways of life. General Seleja's eyes were filled with a willful, perilous beauty. The ways of life were seduced, uncannily, changing to accommodate the life and desires of this princely slab of molten man created by this Milky Way galaxy. Some later swore that they had observed the gods themselves giving birth to Seleja upon the very soil of Africa. Turning slowly, the hearts and souls of the young women folk, both from Imperial Ethiopian court at Addis Ababa and many of the visiting Banta-minian tribes, swooned, hoping, wishing, desiring that the young General Seleja would look upon them with a sensuous greed. General Seleja stood in front of the crowd of his remarkable victory, inclining. General Seleja bowed, gradually smiling, a wide smile, radiant and white like the ivory tusk of the African elephant. So it was with General Seleja. The continent of Africa was at his feet that day. Pass my cup, I am parched, and I will tell you more. A server hurried up through the ranks with a keg of Nigerian brewed Guinness. It was icy cold with a creamy top. Captain Denitsu took it with his right hand as it was offered and drank in deep gulps, assuredly quenching his thirst. He handed the empty cup back to the server. "More, Captain! Tell us more!" shouted the warrior soldiers. "Ah, You want to hear about love? Now they screamed in howling, hearty laughter. Even General Seliger managed to smile whilst remarking, "Captain Denitsu, I didn't know you remembered all of this. And more still, kinsmen, listen!" Once again he raised his voice to coax the audience in his words. "Listen! That day the red of the evening sky melded with the surmounting darkness, and the sun, tired of shining, tired of that day, retired out of sight, leaving darkness and the flickering yellow and blue flames of the tribal torches and that spat sparks and smoke into the illuminated night evening sky as fireflies and other incredulous insects cursed the gravity of the flames like smaller planets cursed the gravity of the sun. I, General Seliger's friend and relative, the fourth son of his uncle, stepped forward with a thin brown webbed translucent shawl dipped in the oil essence of sandalwood. I held it in both hands and lifted it as I approached General Seliger, gracefully wrapping it about the broad shoulders of my cousin, my friend, my general. I pointed to the court of the king. General Seliger nodded and spoke to me, saying, "Danitsu, this night leans heavily upon my thought." As he spoke, five blatter of the imperial household walked up and pulled the body of the slain lion away. "Seliger, all things weigh heavily upon the mind of the great. There is nothing unusual in this. Maybe, my friend, after your show of physical force, you need a display of your prowess in the arts of love." I replied, studying the unmoving lines of his warrior face. "Yes. That sits well with me. Did you see those Banta-minian princesses? The ones with the orange and green pearls upon their necks? I believe they are visiting with Mimajo Binkuwa." "Yes, but that fussy left Kaleja Griot, she is so strict, not like Tanto Joba. At least Tanto permits her pupils to have some fun," I replied, smiling, giggling, then laughing. He joined with me, and for an instant both of us laughed heartily. Suddenly he stopped, abruptly, turning to me as he inclined himself toward the Ethiopian soil, recovering from hearty laughter. "Mimajo Binkuwa, for this should be honored. Our women are our pride. To walk upon the brown face of African soil unmolested is like diamonds in adornment upon my mother's neck, glowing as she walks about the villages of her people. The measure of a nation, Denitsu, is how far our mothers, fully adorned, can walk around without being molested. And for this bequeath of pride upon the peoples of Africa, I will kneel before Mimajo Binkuwa," solemnly said Seliger, with an ingrained sense of pride. I stopped laughing, and with eyes alone smiled into the sincere eyes of my relative, of whom I recall even back then, I felt much pride. Diaspora. Ahead of us, a fire flashed, flickered, as a group of griot musicians performed a song for all in attendance. A chanting song in preferment to the future. It was rhythmic as it resounded about the minds of all who listened, bestowing a vision of a glorious tomorrow, negating the sadness of corruption, disillusionment, and haplessness in those days. We decided to approach the Left Kaleja, Mimajo Binkuwa, to pay our respects. Mimajo Binkuwa stood encircled by a gleeful yet studiously ordered group of young Banta-minians. Each eagerly listened as Mimajo Binkuwa imparted knowledge, wisdom and understanding amongst the neural spaghetti junction of their minds. Their neurons thirsted for what the Left Kaleja had to say. You could see it in their eyes as they inclined upon her like calves upon the teats of a weaning cow. Yes, my beloved Banta-minians, you are the future. Today, as you walk, remember each thought, each word, each act of your hand is like the faculties of the artist, the sculptor, and the philosopher, each creating art forms from thought, word and action. Know that you also have the power to weave the future. Be excellent in all you undertake. Instructed Mimajo Binkuwa to the replete throng about her striking person that day. We joined the visiting Banta-minian group as a young Banta-minian princess from the distant ethnic group of Ashantiwawa in Bawaja, Nigeria, posed a question to Mimajo Binkuwa. If it is as you say, Mimajo, and we do control tomorrow, why? Then are we in all Africa languid compared to our beloved humanity of neighbours upon this earth, as it seems concerning technology and valuable productivity? Are our thoughts, voices, and actions unable to weave an equal future as theirs do? At an instant, I watched as General Seleja turned into the emitting direction of the voice of the Princess Shardhu Shejola. As she spoke, he stared, besotted, to him, I believe, or apparently it seemed, upon a thing of such awakening beauty that he could find no words in his young imperial mind to describe her. Seleja continued to gaze upon her as if in a trance, as the flames from the many torches snapped, crackled, and popped. So silently against the humming of the griot musicians, the slow smoke from the fires, and the velvet voice of Mimajo Binkuwa, as this Left Kaleja answered the inquisitive Banta-minian princess, addressing her response to all standing there bereft of all fear. Shardhu Shejola, do not be deceived by the thoughts, words and actions of the influential amongst our ruling classes who claim to work toward the benevolent advancement of our diaspora. They weave tomorrow. Yes, they have knowledge and wisdom, but they possess merely two of the three elements making up power, the third being understanding. Young Banta-minians, you must seek to understand. And as you attain understanding, you will sympathize, thereby bringing your heart and mind into one place, engendering the rumination of material mass and wave motion that exists in all things. All types of energy are a collective compound of chemicals and ephemeral ingredients that create a definitive purpose. Power is knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. Knowledge is study, observation, peaceful meditation, and memorialized thought. Like the knowledge the young lion brought to the fight against our magnificent Salija. Knowledge passed down from 10,000 years of feline ancestry. Knowledge that it relied upon, unquestionably, even unto the eve and event of its own death. This is knowledge, the storehouse of your ancestral heritage. Now, let me talk of wisdom, those things that form sense to a fool only after the fool has acted and fallen. But if the fool had sought wisdom, learning the art of self-reproof unbidden, then the fool would not be a fool and may have stood amongst us here today. Wisdom, my imperial pupils. Words thereof seemingly innocuous and causeless, sunbathing upon the shores of the mind, are the aged, riddled explanation of the universe of thought, and can be found in the profoundly deep text of all nations. Some call it the Holy Bible, others the Quran, Torah, the Tai Chi, Santeria, Voodoo, or even the ways to enlightenment through Buddha, Sufi, Zoroaster, or the practical teachings of Confucius. Any collection of the words of wisdom has an inexhaustible list of names, and so it must, because it is of itself wisdom to know that our kind is infinitesimal, ergo an indefinite diverse beauty of a type forever never ending, like the innumerable stars of heaven. Beware, my dearest pupils, the essence of wisdom is proverbial, an irreducible signpost defining a group of actions and their peculiar analogous paths to your future. Finally, my beloved Banta-minian, let me reveal to you the path to understanding. Understanding, utterly understanding a thing is to fall in love with it, its purpose, its purity, its poison. And when you are in love and your love is profound, the collective compound of knowledge, wisdom, and understanding that comes together in you will give you power. A finite energy that will crowd about you as you do here now about me, awaiting my instruction. So will the finite powerful energy about you, waiting obediently for you to wield it. So, beautiful Shardhu, in answer to your question, our influential dignitaries of the ruling classes of Africa do not have a comparable love for the soil of Africa as our beloved neighbors around this earth love their land's soil, and so vicariously it follows that Africans cannot weave a comparative tomorrow. General Salija heard all Mimajo Binkuwa said, even as he continued unerringly to gaze upon Shardhu Shejola. Suddenly, she glimpsed his stare and became irritated, as a young Banta-minian princess full of pride is wont to be. She turned to return his gaze now, with contemptuous eyes, resting upon our general. But in that instant, their neurons rushed to share neurological entrapments of an entangled nature that was beyond the will of both he and her, and love ensnared them. Suddenly, the young Salija post-haste walked over to Shardhu, taking her hand unbidden, and in that moment, he declared the honesty of his heart, as the dark muscular ripple of his physique enamored her total thought. I am Salija, a heir of the Royal African line of Banta-minia, from which I receive knowledge, the same knowledge you also possess. I have wisdom, as my left collega is Tanto Yohoba, even as yours is Mimajo Binkuwa, the most learned. Tonight, this very evening, to me has been given understanding as I love you and all you are and will become. Through you my power is complete, for by my thoughts, words and actions in this moment, I have woven my tomorrow, the instant I heard your voice and set eyes upon you. You must tell me your full name and ancestry. Ha! Presumptuous Selija! I am no innocent fool. I too have found understanding in my left collegia's candor. I am in love with the many illustrious and lush regions of dearest Nigeria, my home, and so my power lies tied to that soil, and with no man, even a most handsome regal warrior as black and beautiful as you appear now before me. Mimajo Binkuwa overheard the dictum of the Princess Shardhu Shejola and lifted her finely aged oaken-like hand. The crowd stopped murmuring. The music had ceased playing, and all turned toward the stern mahogany-hued left collegia. Princess Shardhu Shejola of Banta-minia, the most beautiful creature before us. You are the exponential testamentary embodiment of divine preferment ever to be born upon African soil. Your tomorrow is woven. Before you stands a godlike son of the Banta-minian tribe who will bend winds by his very will. He is yours and will be until his fall, which will come about by your words here tonight. Don't you know who stands before you? Not merely Selija, but Africa itself. And old Africa, by your words and deeds to come, must now pass, becoming a distant memory. Then, for the first of many innumerable moments thereafter, Princess Shardhu Shejola looked meekly upon the youthful General Selija, took his hand and held it gently betwixt hers, as warmth, a sharing of diffusive emotive power, coursed through her heart into his at that moment. She knew that all of us, with few exceptions, kill that thing we profess to love. This resolute warrior of tomorrow, before her today, a prince of Africa, and to be tomorrow's heroic rebel general in a foreign land, who so in love with her today, tomorrow must surely die in pursuit of her heart. A heart interned into the very bosom of the soil of Shardhu Shejola's beloved Nigeria, by his hand that she continued to clasp, Shardhu Shejola led General Selija to a large stately wooden chair that had been given as a commemorative by the King of Thailand to his father, the Ethiopian King, as a gift after both kings as princes shared 3 years at Oxford University in England, dorm room mates. The chair boasted actual carvings depicting memorable scenes from the time of that collegial friendship. General Selija, aware now of his beloved, his power, and his eventual death, sat like a great cloud seated itself upon over the pinnacle of Mount Kilimanjaro, replete with all the shades of its existence, exposed, explicit for all to see. The sandalwood-soaked shawl, I had placed about his mighty shoulders was damp, revealing each ripped muscle of his physique, his chest like two magnificent breastplates, fit to be worn only by the heroes, Sunjata of Mali, or Achilles the Achaean, relaxed. His gaze all this time remained upon Shardhu Shejola. She stood back now, still clasping his hand at its arm's length, admiring him. To her it seemed that he appeared to have become the embodiment of the young lion slain earlier that day. Fierce, relentless, and incredibly attractive. To herself, thought Shardhu, Sulija looks invincible, but this is not true, for today I, in my girlish immaturity, have slain a god. At last, Shardhu Shejola, a Banta-minian princess and today a minister of Nigeria, fell deeply in love with our general. Yes, comrades, General Salija. And before all in attendance, still clasping his hand, she carefully wrapped the length of his long arm about the waistline circumference of her fine feminine form until coming within the touch of his breath upon her royal chocolate cheek. She lifted herself to sit comfortably curled up upon the great knees of the general. He seated regally in his father's chair. There they remained, still, motionless, until the final flickering torch extinguished itself against the impingement of an incongruent breeze that had travelled all the way through the space-time we call the future to where they sat as she joined with him. Mimajo Binkuwa bowed deeply before the fated couple, prophesying to those there that night, "Our race will now evolve." And that, my warriors, comrades, is the story of our beloved General Salija and the love he speaks of. Who now thinks it is wrong to talk of love on the eve of victory? Cried Captain Denitsu. It was silent. Suddenly, a tumultuous upsurge of sound struck fear into the hearts of those that heard the battle cry of the 10,000 rebels from afar. Unwittingly, Captain Denitsu had slain the hearts of 10,000 soldiers. For each one of the 10,000 warrior soldiers encamped upon the hill at Tajitola now loved Shardhu Shejola, and each warrior soldier desired to see the imperial minister as their queen and Africa's empress. The captain turned to the place that General Salija had been seated, listening to his oration, but he was gone. Captain Denitsu said nothing to the warriors. He suspected that he surely knew where General Salija had gone, and indeed, he knew that before the battle ensued, the general would most certainly return. Leadership.
Yeah.
Mr. President, the British Ambassador Ronan Clark has arrived. He awaits you, your arrival at Terminal 2.
Thank you, Minister Shejola. Please arrange for me to meet him there. I do not want to be late, instructed President Inchok-Hukwe.
Excellency, your presidential limousine awaits you. Will you not be late? Or you will, we will not be late.
Good.
The president stood at the executive bar's panoramic glass screen that stretched from one corner of the bar lounge to the other. The view was cinematic, permitting the entirety of the airport to be seen from the vantage point of the executive bar suite lounge, a quarter of a mile from the airport terminal. The president was led to his limousine. He walked with a hint of wariness in his stride, the knowledge possessed by the former general turned political leader visibly weighing heavily upon his mind. His eyes still bright, but scorched to glaring with the irresolvable events that had unfolded of late all about his rule. Entrenched faint fissures lined his forehead, some deep, some vague, some complex, each reflecting the type of issue he now faced. His skin darkened as he left the cool shade of the building, walking toward his limousine. 1, 2, 3 seconds later, he was seated inside the presidential limousine, on the left reclining into the sumptuous dark leather seat. Inhaling the polished perfume of its sophistication, his minister, Shardhu Shejola, seated herself on his right. He relaxed somewhat, slowly swinging the gaze of his large head in a single motion to his left. Out of that window, far, far, far into the distance, the president gazed upon dark smoke, rising in fits and spits, flitting upward, dispersing, dissipating, formless, like the issues he now faced. And then, to be repeatedly stoked at a malignant base, hidden from his view, that recreated the spurious trend of ceaseless smoke again and again. President Inchok-Hukwe understood it was no coincidence that the smoke emanated from the direction of the feckless hilltop township of Tajitola. Even so, as far away as the sputtering smoke appeared to the president, he recalled to his mind yesterday, when all he saw was a vague mist, like a foggy, odious hue, indefinite yet constantly curtailed by wind, the weather, but never persistent as how it had evolved to be this moment. He peered at it. Tomorrow it would be closer, surmised His Excellency, President Inchok-Hukwe. Machiavelliana. Shardhu Shejola, his Minister of State, took an innocent liberty that only Minister Shejola could. Resting her soft, slender hand upon the President's forearm, clasping the circumference of his intricately woven short velvet pile sleeve with its unified Republic of Nigeria emblem stitched in elegantly embroidered patterns from the cuffing gold thread midway up to the forearm of his jacket sleeve. She squeezed gently upon the president's forearm. The president turned away from the view of the distant smoke to look at his minister Shejola. She sought his eyes against established protocol and held the president's gaze. His character, his persona, and his spirit were not taken to weakness, but for a moment of respite, President Inchokhukwe acknowledged the gaze of his ministerial aide. The outer rim of his eyes gently swelled, his pupils relaxing, letting in more light, permitting the imperial minister for a moment to gain a glimpse into the soul of this leader. As briefly as the entrance was open, so it was closed, and his minister knew to remove her hand from the forearm of the president. The limousine rolled forward smoothly upon and over the uneven tarmac. Nigeria's sun was bright, and the road and buildings were bleached bright to a pale, colourless hue that paid parsimonious homage to the overabundant sunlight by reflecting it to intensity, multiplying the effect of a photon parcel-induced late spring drought. Minister Shejola, the Pan-African meeting is scheduled for next Wednesday. I think I want to drive, not fly. This will permit me to visit the villages. My people will appreciate the time I spend with them. I want to begin travelling on Friday. On Sunday I will host a ceremony in Lagos. Inform General Salija to make ready the presidential palace at Shargeos for my arrival. Also, I would like to dine with Ambassador Xu Jiangmei and his enchanting wife Mikili Jiangmei on Monday. Yes, Excellency. Will His Excellency permit a consideration as to the expediency of flight? You concern yourself with matters beyond your office, Minister. I merely extend the expediency of my office to the celebration of His Excellency's plans, ever seeking to offer humble additions. The President's face creased to a smile. Minister Shejola, my dear advisor, I see your conceit that you would have me avoid the rebels. Excellency, with respect, is it treason to seek safety in all matters for the patriarch of our nation? If it were not, Minister Shejola, mindless men would and still do ensnare their leaders with indulgences best left unearthed. But come, dear minister, if the mind of your president is what you seek, let your need be assuaged, for a time at least. Indulge me of your thoughts, your concerns are honourable, so do not be shy. Excellency, I fear for you. The rebels come closer each day, and there is no staying their advance. We cannot placate them as we have done so in the past. What drives them is hidden from us. Minister Shejola, regardless of what drives rebels toward treason and treachery, we remain a client nation of the British government. Why else would we be receiving the British ambassador at a time like this? The British have agreed to check the advance of the rebels. They assure me that my rule will be maintained, upheld with force if necessary. In seeking ever your favour, Excellency, why do you reveal scepticism in your soul? Because I may not know who leads the rebels, but I know what drives the rebels. Micronet technology. And the British, I think, do not know to what extent, yet arrogance is the self-aggrandizement of the power before, even in the absence of fact. The British epitomize arrogance, yet have they not a record of achievement worth cautious reliance upon? It is as His Excellency perceives it to be. Yet I break with protocol and declare my fear for you, Excellency, because history doesn't bear good testimony to foreigners' credibility upon our alien soil. A credibility upon alien soil. From the myth of the wooden horse of Troy to Belgium and not-so-good King Leopold's reprehensible butchery of the Congolese at the dawn of their day. As one who seeks under no duress the glorious continuation of His Excellency's rule, might the Chinese ambassador Zhang Mei, or even the Russians, be in this hour more favourable advisers than the British ambassador?
Minister Shejola, your intrigue, well, let me just say, it intrigues me. Will you not elucidate further to the satisfaction of your president?
Excellency, as always is this my pleasure to do. The British seek to offer you protection against a threat they have yet limited knowledge of or power over. Their offer of aid is hollow and avoidable promise like the bankruptcy of their former glory. She lowered her voice. The chairperson of the TAP Consortium, Diana TAP, offered to you for the benefit of the Nigerian people. Micronet technology, she offered it in full awareness of the Unlawful Body Enhancement Act 2024. Yet, according to my sources, she has not been indicted under the Act. In fact, it is she who challenges the scope of Section 7 and 8 of that legislation this very moment in London as we speak. At the Royal Courts of Justice, is there willpower left to the Western Alliance? It seems to me their resolve is negated by the potential of Micronet technology. Excellency, yes, in wisdom at that time you declined Miss Tapp's offer. However, she appears from research to be quite a determined and officious character, somewhat of an exceptional calibre of an individual. And Excellency, quite different, vastly different indeed. I have been told, if we were to rescind our decline of her offer and enter into agreements with the Chinese and Russians to protect us from any future British encroachment upon our sovereignty, would it not open a conciliatory channel to closer links with our Pan-African colleagues? Once we secure a Pan-African alliance, the rebels will be absorbed back into the governmental process because their reason for justifying a coup d'etat would be removed. The Chinese and Russians would have no power over any member of the Pan-African alliance, and the British, ergo the Western alliance, and their corporate conglomerate entrails, would have nothing to bargain with. As Minister Shejola paused, the President caught her gaze. He considered her comment with a long, lingering look into the eyes of his adviser, wondering then and beyond that moment how she knew of Diana Tapp's offer.
Minister Shejola, tell me, are we not merely exchanging one master for another? Will we still not be mastered? And if this is true, why the exchange?
To an extent, Excellency, your question is your symbolic personification of wisdom. We will continue to be mastered as the sun masters the earth and God masters the sun. This is inevitability at work. So say the Abages, yet strangely, the left collegers differ in opinion greatly. But we will no longer be mastered by other nations. Nevertheless, we would need to ensure that Miss Diana Tapp is an honourable individual and worth entering into an agreement with.
Of course, of course. Let me think about it.
Ambassador. Remember me, The presidential limousine arrived at Terminal 2. The British ambassador, Ronan Clark, stood with a glistening but not drenched face of sweat, added to relatively large blotches of wet patches of sweat visible on his white cotton shirt and beige khaki pants. He stood in the shade of Abuja International Airport. It was 97 degrees in the shade and 118 degrees in the sun. The president's chauffeur stepped out of the prestigious vehicle, making his way to the door to the passenger side closest to the sidewalk, opening that door for Ambassador Ronan Clark. Minister Shardhu Shejola made her exit from the presence of the president. Briefly, she looked into the face of the British ambassador, lowering her eyes and beautiful head as a sign of respect. Ambassador Ronan Clark acknowledged the minister with a slight nod and smile, more in recognition of being taken aback at the mesmerizing beauty of the minister than a political agenda of any kind, though he had been briefed regarding her present pernicious potential. Ambassador Ronan Clark entered into the limousine and seated himself alongside the president on his right. The presidential limousine was the second vehicle in the cavalcade to pull away, heading off in the direction of the palatial abode of the president of Nigeria. The third limousine, within the entourage, contained Minister Shejola, who was also a guest at the palatial residence of President Inchokhukwe. After a late midnight dinner attended by the luminaries of upper crust Nigerian society, President Inchokhukwe and British Ambassador Clark strolled a while through the palace's fresh herb grove within the confines of the presidential quarter of the state home. The early hours of the new day silently descended upon both men as they spoke of family and sport. Then President Inchokhukwe's mood and conversation stiffened. Ambassador, the people of Nigeria wish to extend their gratitude through me for His Majesty's government's assurance that our current state will be secured and any aggressive civil forces will be opposed. Yes, Excellency, our overriding objective is to maintain stability upon your behalf.
But Ambassador, stability can be purchased at different prices depending upon which market you seek, a sale or seller. And may I add, quality is affected by market, not necessarily price.
Your Excellency, His Majesty's government can assure you that it will spare no tool in the protection of His Excellency's interests, responded Ronan Clark, looking lingeringly at the president as they walked. Why now? He thought, as the president entered the presidential office suite ahead of him, making his way to his chair. Love.
Shardhu, Shardhu,
whispered General Saleja as he snuck into the ministerial guest suite occupied this night by the Minister of Nigeria. She stood out of sight in the ensuite bathroom. How beautiful is my Shardhu? Poetically reposed General Salija to himself, then softly so he crooned out loud, a magnificent creature created of humanity, and she belongs to beloved Nigeria first, and to me second. She is my queen, and I love her to distraction of all else, with such loyalty only known in the forging of the bond between an expectant mother and the life that slips without of the vaginal walls of her parted legs. All I can I will, and all I will I must, for Shardhu my beloved. I feel her essence coursing through me, all over me, from my wonderful mind etching itself its contrast of fun and daring, like a needle with threads of endless affection. Endless woman, endless tomorrow. A perfect threat to my now, my today, my way. I cannot assuage the tide, I cannot prevent the flood. My mind is overrun with her face, her image, her eyes. My neurons firing without control at her name or a sense of her closeness. The attraction astounds me, frightens me, and at once I am weak. I dare not let her see me, me the quivering prey, all defeated from mind to heart to groin, and yet how it feels so unlike any feeling I have ever known, any hope I have ever had, and any wish I so feared its grant. A slain heart within a slain soul, housed in a warrior's cherry black body, mature, graying, coveting a fearful hope that steals my me, my now, and my all. I am in love with her. I declare me like a flower at the warming rays of spring's onset, and in so doing understand mortality that way I now do. For at once I see the tomorrow and the end of it all, and to fear my tomorrow I do not, because I am in love with her. Oh, silly her, smart and witty like a goddess in full knowledge, toying with her desires all the time, trapped as me, ensnared, knowing that she is in love with me too. Selfishly I want her, all of her, her gaze, her smile, her sounds, her constant attention, like the celestial bodies crave the sun, its dangers, its sustenance, its devour. To become a part of her, her to be a part of me, as one to become something new. Individual, an icon of many facets. Youth, maturity, intelligence, culture, African, Ethiopian, Nigerian, and more intelligence. My tongue falters upon each word, each letter, each line, because this is my testament, my wish that only God can grant, and I fear he will, to restate his glorious essence, his omnipotence over mere me, mere her. I am slain. I am defeated. Take me to the lair of your heart. Press upon me with your brown breasts. Look upon me with your ancient eyes and riddled forehead, like gentle waves ascertaining me. Knowing me, I am yours. Show mercy in your desires. I am yours. I beg to live like a slave to your desires. I am yours, totally, completely, absolutely, and without disgrace. For I love you more than any other can or will ever. I love you like the immortals love,
knowing their love is infinite. I love you like kindness loves a deep bow of respectable affection. I love you like a wounded beast loves the death knell blow. I love you like a starry-eyed child loves the last moments of Christmas Eve. I love you like I have never loved any other person or thing. I love you 1,000 lifetimes, 1,000,000 galaxies. And standing here, I confess, I love you a little more than all the above, and still more, fallen in love with you, Shardhu, I am. Sweet. Minister Shejola, listen to the words of General Salija from behind the wood slat door of the ensuite bathroom. Her regal back pressed up against the wall, her eyes seen through the wooden partition ahead of her. Through it, past it, beyond it, into a distant reality created in her own mind, containing Salija, her king and queen, ruling over an Africa, ruminating with power, people and pride. Tearfully she reveals herself to Salija, gliding effortlessly from the ensuite to the oval-shaped bath area of the large window that overlooked the western courtyard of the guest palace quarters. Salija touches her perfect slender brown hand as she stands with her back to him, listening to his approach, waiting for his embrace. She turns to face him, holding the general's gaze, piercing through his eyes, waiting for his embrace. Deep into his soul, where she senses a raging flame of desire for her, her cheekbones rise up, revealing her immaculate teeth in a gorgeous smile that further sparks the fired desires of the general's heart. It is profoundly night now, wispy clouds lingering the deep blue night sky, adding a textured beauty to the twinkling of stars seemingly embedded in the very bosom of the various cloud stars Minister Shejola has been wishing upon with prescient desire over the past 15 years. Her fingers, like feather with strength, find their way up his arms to rest upon his chest. Then, from there, in one motion, she cups both her hands about the back and side of the general's shaven head, pulling his face respectfully to hers, seeking his lips, her eyes never leaving his, as she immerses her lips upon the general's lips, lingering there, lips loving being there, kissing a general, gazing into the eyes of her general. The intensity increases as their bodies, now appearing as one form, drift away from the view of the window to the center of the room, to stand upon the thick pile crimson rug covering the varnished flooring. Ritualistically, his warrior hands turn to a seductive art form, delicately shifting the single strap of the beautiful Shardhu Shejola's dress over her perfectly defined shoulder, letting the lilac pastel evening dress slip down to rest upon one of her dark, taut nipples. The strap balances there as she appears like art, priceless, rare, there upon an island of rug in the middle of the polished floor, like an adornment upon the uniform of a decorated soldier. Now she writhes, gently stretching upward to intensify their kissing. The dress's strap slips, completely revealing her magnificent body. A piece of perfection, unveiled in the absence of clothes. Adore me, Selija, adore me. Is this ever what you want, my general? Whispers the minister to the general betwixt kisses and caresses. Harmoniously, General Selija groans. Yes, 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 as his goddess permits the delectation of his desire upon the beautiful blackness of her regal body. Treason. President, quickly, follow me. The president steered, apparently surprised at his unlikely hero, the British ambassador, Roland Clark. A bullet whistled past the president's left ear, lodging itself into a picture of his father meeting the Pope in 2018 Vatican City. The picture hanging on the wall trembles momentarily as the bullet strikes it, then the bullet implodes, displacing space-time, sucking a 10-centimeter diameter of the picture into a void of nothingness created by the inverted gravity at its core. The instability of the space-time void persists for approximately 5 seconds. The president is pushed sideways as the wave motion of the displaced space-time uncoordinately arranges and rearranges the furniture in the presidential office suite. He crashes to the floor, unable to cushion his fall. His head bangs against the parquet flooring, sending him into a state of semi-consciousness. The little time left to Ambassador Roland Clark starts rapidly leaking away. He can see the first unit of rebels hastening in the direction of the presidential office suite. He is pretty sure that they want the president because they need him to legitimize their coup. The sanction of this victim will be the ransom upon the president's life. Both agile and fast, Ronan maneuvers with precision, slipping through the open doorway of the French casement shutters, kicking both doors shut as he enters. The moment the doors slam, banging shut, 3 bullets hit the French casement shutters, smashing the middle slats to splinters, leaving a large gaping hole as space-time is displaced around it. Ronan Clark got low, incredibly low,
as the displaced space-time creates a deadly wave motion just above the nape of his bowed head. He can feel the force of the wave motion as it pushes him even lower. He did not need encouragement. He got even lower, crouching, pressing, almost clinging like a swamp toad with sweated fingertips to the flat, polished parquet flooring. Better than being caught in the path of a space-time displacement void caused by those bullets' aftershock, he reassures himself. As an early sunset approaches, violet red begins to colour the sky in washes across the horizon, unable to halt the approaching darkness as it retreats relentlessly toward the presidential palatial palace. The rebels, under cover of the receding dusk and bloody red sunrise, overrun President Inchokhukwe's palace, killing quickly upon sight women, children, and the elderly, for good measure, with vigour, anybody they fell upon, like Ben's horde of mice in Willard. The rebels swarm about the palatial palace, gardens, herb groves, and living quarters in their wake, leaving blood and gore. They begin to traverse the herbal grove in the vicinity of the president's office. Ronan Clark now knows he is literally seconds. Plucking up his courage, upping himself to a stooping stance, he leapt off, making a dash toward the semi-concussed president as he wriggles under the side wall cabinet like a stout British badger burrowing into fresh earth. Ronan Clark, at that precise moment, somehow feels he must dive. He does. A rain of six bullets hits the spot he just occupied. Material havoc of the type just described occurs. He lands on top of the president's recently polished mahogany table, twisting his body so that he is able to slide, almost glide effortlessly across the middle of the mahogany table, spinning like a fallen skater on an ice rink. Two bullets lance through the splattered slats of the French casement entrance, just missing his left knee. The bullets continue along their trajectory, landing in a picture of the president's mother before implosion. Kapow! Ronan Clark is forced off the table by the space-time displacement effect of the bullets. He lands on top of the president, jolting him back to near consciousness. The president groans, turning to look at him. He says nothing, because the gaze of the president's eyes are words enough for both men. "We must get out of here," repeatedly, silently scolds Ronan Clark to himself. Both men hear the thud, 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 punching, boom of the rebels' boots pummeling up the stairway in their direction. "President! President, is there a secret escape route out of the palace?" cries out Ronan Clark.
Ambassador, why? Why?
President, listen to me. We must get out of here, or we will be killed. Your people need you alive, President.
I'm trying to find the lever under this side wall cabinet. A red lever.
Ronan Clark shifts position, moving himself next to the President's swollen left cheek. The President's face looks like a prize pumpkin, the largest ever to enter a competition. Ronan Clark can see the red lever under the side wall cabinet. More bullets. A burst of gunfire crashes home with collateral devastation into the wall by the coward president and ambassador. Space-time begins to dilate around them as a myriad of tiny implosions, like the death of a thousand baby stars, begin to make the office atmosphere unstable.
Ronan grabs the collar of the president's jacket into his left hand and clasps it tight, tense in his arm, his biceps bulging under his torn shirt sleeve. With the other hand stretched out before him, he slides forward like a monster snake that has just swallowed a wild pig, whole, ungracefully, greedily, but determined to seek safety, to seek life. A quiet place during digestion. His fingers clasp the lever tight, pulling with all his might. Aggression. The last of the French casement doors with its slats intact are kicked off and away to one side of its hinges. Two massive soldiers' boots land onto the threshold with an ungainly thud.
Inchokhukwe. We are here to talk,
bellows out a mighty military voice. The lever comes away from its keep into Ronan Clark's hand. Oh, fuck, he curses as he looks at the president, both now huddled, looking like cooked sausages in the corner of a sizzling frying pan, waiting to be plucked out by the rebels, out and devoured. Abruptly, the area of flooring they occupy jettisons, and the floor rises at an angle. The lever has finally disengaged itself from its keep. More barrage of bullets ensues, 1,000 showers of them it seems, but it was too late. They slide down a shaft opening under the sidewall cabinet, down, down through the open roof of the president's limousine. The limousine's roof slides to a shut, and the limousine's automatic emergency driver is engaged, igniting the engine, simultaneously pulling forward as a concealed garage door suddenly bursts outward, taking 6 rebel lives along with it. 5 more rebels come running up to the sudden orifice in the south wall of the palatial residence. They open fire at the limousine. It is bulletproof. Thus continues picking up speed, whizzing past 3 of the rebels. Of the other 2, one kneels as the other swings a Russian-made rocket launcher from his back into the waiting arms of the kneeling rebel warrior soldier. He catches it, aims it at the limousine, now 20 meters ahead of him, accelerating. The street rocket is launched, whoosh, crack, following the rear window of the limousine. The kneeling soldier's right shoulder jerks back as the rocket is fired, throwing the young warrior to the dusty street in a heap. The limousine senses the approaching rocket and releases a pulse with an encoded command that is decoded by the rocket's artificially intelligent microprocessor function, causing the rocket momentarily to slow, giving the limousine a priceless moment to switch direction, swing a sharp hard right down a sandy alley. The rocket recovers its trajectory, but it is too late as it attempts to recalibrate to follow its target prey down the same sandy alley, instead crashing, hitting the street corner, kapow, causing a massive explosion. Eventually, General Saliger arrives at the president's office, heavily armed, appearing even more ferocious than he had been seen late that evening on national network television, discussing the purpose of martial law. From the days of his youth, he was not to be mistaken as a man of peace.
Shardhu! Shardhu! He shouts into his CCC.
No answer. He tries again. Still no answer. But this time he allows the call to slip into holograph mail message. We are here, and the president has escaped. If you get this message, what must I do? Mockery.
Minister Shardhu Shejola stirs as she sleeps. Her warm body slides around on the satin sheets. Her chocolate thighs twist, carrying her legs and feet with them. Even in sleep, in this uncomfortable sleep, she creates a new art form of beauty distressed on satin. Suddenly, her buttocks tense and the tension uncoils itself along her spine and around her rib cage, now over her demure breasts, each pressed profoundly down into the satin sheet, covering the mattress, causing her neck to straighten like the exquisite sword arm of a samurai. Her jaw mumbles, "No," in Yoruba, Igbo, and finally the ancient tongue of Banta-mina, causing her plume-filled cheekbones to glow and her eyes like an elegant class of cat to open, that the gloss of the moon's reflection remains clear and full in her eyes. Tersely grabbing at the edges of the mattress to either side of her with each fine chocolate finger clasping the satin sheets as she pulls herself up so that her neck lifts and her breasts hang, suspending from her chest. The moon's receding glow flickers through the bright brown valley between her breasts, each shimmering with beads of sweat as the minister moves her body to the sit-up position. Staring at nothing around her, there she sits, motionless, panting, gently in thought upon her dilemma. The sudden appearance of the British ambassador in Nigeria, so close to her success. I cannot let him leave Africa. He knows too much. No, he cannot leave. I must find him, detain him, occupy his time until I attend and return from the meeting of the signatories. So she considers within her mind. He is dangerous. I can sense it. Self-consciously, she reflects to herself, and in that moment she becomes cautiously aware of the melee of emotions she has allowed to wash over her mind, like the all-consuming encroachment of a tide upon a lonely pebble on a vast beach. Slipping from the satin sheet-lined bed and through the opening to the mosquito curtain, she takes her yellow lace gown, sliding one hand and then the arm into the sleeve, throwing the remaining gown swiftly, elegantly over and around her shoulders, sliding her other arm into the other sleeve, wrapping the front of the gown around, covering her exposed crotch, looking like a polished brown leather pouch by Mulberry of London. Shardhu walks across the hardwood flooring to her dresser, sliding out a CCC from its TCC sleeve, gently touching two digits on the luminous feather touchpad, checking the mirror, ensuring that she is decent, then setting the CCC down upon the edge of the dresser. A hologram of General Saleja emerges, looking distressed, disheveled, and gasping for breath. Her eyes widen, a semblance of shock instantly maps itself over her prior facial expression of serenity. "Saleja!" screams Shardhu, breaking with formality as her heart freezes, then realizes that this is the fall of her mighty lover, a strong love, powerful friend and ally. General Saleja, who together with Minister Shardhu Shejola towered above every challenge that they encountered from their Banta-minian upbringing, dreaming, desiring them together between kisses and romantic caresses, plotting a utopian society from the ground up, like the nanotechnologist scientists of the early 21st century. Then, as now, the minister knew how to wield power, yet in her is also vested femininity, a gracious femininity
that this very moment cannot be assuaged as the image of her powerful, regal, African lover's holographic figure falls to the ground, quivering under many bloody dark wounds. In a hazing, electronically wireless agony, the piteous flailed hologram of General Salija cries, "Shardhu! Shardhu! My love, we have been deceived. Run, flee, hurry from here, quickly, right now, in the dusk, my African queen. No mockery like this hour made whole can ever rob us of our love. I will carry that love with me as I change." And General Salija Mengwitsu, surrogate son of Nigeria and disloyal leader of the rebel forces in that lush land, died. An elapse, the briefest, a moment. A dark green robe strewn over the high back of a sofa chair in the minister's bedroom, Sweet finds itself in her clutch. With the same grasping motion, she grabs a purse, sandals, adorning herself with all three articles, including her CCC, slid in between her fingers, delirious, running through her bedroom suite. Shardhu makes her way to the guest suite door entrance, through it, heart pounding, dashing out into the ministerial courtyard, brimming over with 100 gleaming 21st century state-of-the-art smoke blackened laser pistol long barrels, each evenly aimed, evidenced by the cruel little red dots upon her head, heart and hands. The end of part 1.